not been incredible being here and worshiping together this morning? To look around and to see so many faces, to have troubles finding a seat, is it not incredible to be able to experience that? It's just too bad that none of it's real. It's just too bad that it's all made up. It's just too bad that God isn't really real, that he doesn't really exist. And obviously, if God doesn't exist, then that means Jesus, who claimed to be God, was just some guy who lived a long time ago. And I know that a lot of people have stood up on a platform like this, that a lot of pastors have stood up and they have told you of all of these great things. And we look at history and it's pretty clear that he lived. Not a lot of people are arguing about that one. But being God, I mean, come on. Obviously, if God doesn't exist, then Jesus can't be God. And if he wasn't God, I think we can safely assume that yes, he lived and yes, he died, because everybody dies. How he died, we can argue about that one. But the whole rising from the dead thing at the end of it, come on. I know we live in a day where we can all have our truth. But that one seems a little bit far-fetched. But I suppose if that is your truth, then let's just run with it for just a little bit. So you say that God is real. You say Jesus is real, that he really lived, he really died, he really rose again. Well, I think it's pretty safe to say that if God is real, he is not good. How can you say God is good after what just happened in Nashville 3 weeks ago, or less than 3 weeks ago? How can you say that God is good after what just happened in Sullivan less than 2 weeks ago? How can you make that claim? How can you make that claim with all of the atrocities that happen all over the world? You claim that he is real and you claim that he is all powerful, and he lets that stuff happen? I think it's pretty safe to say he's not all that good. But if that's your truth, that you want to say that he's real and you want to say that he's good, I got a newsflash for you. You don't deserve him at all. Now, I know that here in southern Indiana, we like to think that we're real good people. We're not as bad as those people out in Portland, Oregon by any means, right? We can sit and we can talk down on them all year long because they are way worse than we are, but man, I've lived here almost 3 years, and I can safely say that there are a lot of bad people here in southern Indiana. And actually, I would say that I've seen people who come here for an hour to an hour and a half on Sunday morning that certainly do not live the same way the rest of the week as they live when they're in this building on Sunday morning. And for those of you who we haven't seen since last Easter, I can only imagine what your life has been like for the past year. You don't deserve him. What do you have to contribute to him? Tell me, what do you have to contribute to him? How do you think that you deserve? But if you want to believe in this whole grace thing that people talk about, that pastors like me have gotten up and talked about for centuries, if you want to believe in all of that, well, let's just run with that one for a little bit. So he's real and he's good and he gives you grace. Why would you want a God who is willing to take you in? With all of your problems and all of your mistakes and all of your faults, why would you want it? You know what that God sounds like to me? He sounds desperate. He sounds like, I mean, to give of your own son for a bunch of worthless people doesn't sound like a good father to me. It sounds like a father who is desperate to get people to worship him. And you know what? There are plenty of other people out there who are desperate to have your worship. Why not just worship them instead? They're all over social media. They're all over the news. You can find one. Just pick and choose. Even one of his own followers called it. You know, that guy that you read those stories about how he was walking on this road and suddenly he was blinded and then boom, all of a sudden now he believes. You know, that guy, he called it centuries ago. When he said that at this resurrection of the dead, if there isn't any of that, then Christ hasn't been raised. And if Christ hasn't been raised, here it is, then our preaching is useless. And your faith, or that faith that you act like you have, that faith that you tell people that you have until you leave this building, your faith, it's useless. Useless. I'm sorry that for so many years, pastors have been getting up and they've been telling you different. It turns out it's a really good way to get rich. It's not working for me, but there's a lot of them out there that have made a whole lot of money by spreading this story and by getting people to follow them. It's a great way to gain power. But none of it's real. We can come in here and we can sing our songs. We can act like we care about it all. Because deep down we know that it's all fake. So now, you can take off the rest of your day. You can stop worrying about all this stuff. You can stop worrying about all the rules that you have to follow and all the things that you have to do, and you could just go and you can just live your life. But what if, by chance, since we're considering that option and since I'm informing you of that option, what if by chance all of that is actually the lie? What if all of those doubts that come in and all of those accusations that come in, what if those are all the lie? And what if, just roll with me here for a little bit. Now, some of you are sitting out here and you're like, man, I wish that a pastor would have said this a long time ago. My mom wouldn't have been dragging me to church for my entire life. I wouldn't have to come here every Easter Sunday morning. I wish someone had said this. But what if you would consider with me for just 10 minutes, what if all of that was the lie? And there's something else out there that is true. What if there is an enemy that we like to deny is there, an enemy that is unseen, that is trying to convince us that God is not real, that is trying to convince us that God is not good? What if that enemy knows what happens when we see the actual truth? There is a generation out here, and I wouldn't even say one generation. There are generations that are seeking for truth and being told that they can define it themselves, that we can each have our own truth. But what if there really only is one truth? Would you not want to know that truth? Through his life and through his death, and through his resurrection, if all of that did indeed happen, I believe that Jesus proved to us truth. He showed us truth. By overcoming death, he showed us that we are, in fact, lovable. That we are, in fact, worth something. He showed us that God is so good that he would sacrifice of himself for those around him, for those that he loves. What if the enemy is trying to convince us all of that is false so that he can be the one to gain power? And what if there is an enemy who is accusing our hearts, who is attacking us by giving us these accusations about how we are no good, about how your mistakes define you? If there's an enemy doing that, and if Jesus' death and resurrection are true, then he exposed the lies of that enemy that he's been trying to cover up ever since. And if all of that about Jesus is true, then it means that we can have freedom from those chains that bind us down, that we don't have to be defined by the mistakes that we've made in the past, or the mistakes that we're making today, or the mistakes that we're going to make in the future. But instead, we can be defined by one who doesn't call us sinners saved by grace, who doesn't call us sinners at all, but who calls us children of God, who calls us his saints. Not because we're perfect, but because he looks and he sees what we can be, rather than looking back and seeing what we are. And he gives us freedom from all of that that binds us down. What if the enemy is trying to convince us that that isn't true? What if there is an enemy who is trying to destroy your soul with pride? Who is trying to convince you that you, if this God exists in the first place, you definitely don't need him, and you certainly don't need all of those wackadoos that decide that they're going to follow him. All of those people who come to a building like this on a Sunday morning and give of their money, I mean, what's up with that? What if you don't need all them, he's saying? What if, even if he does exist, you can be God yourself? Well, if Jesus truly did live, and if Jesus truly did die, and if Jesus truly did rise again, I mean, if a man predicts his own death and then says that he's going to overcome death, then can't we at least for a second consider that all of the other stuff that he said was true too? That all of the other promises that he made, that those were true too? What if it's as simple and as complicated at the same time as there is an enemy who is trying to convince you that this life of following Jesus, this life of worshiping Jesus, is really just about following rules and it's about laws? And instead, through his death and his resurrection, his sacrifice for you, his sacrifice for me, his overcoming of a grave was his way of saying, I have come to give you life. What if it's true when he said that there is a thief who has come to steal and to kill and destroy, but I have come that you may have life and have it richly and fully, to have a satisfying life? When the devil knocks, what he brings are lies, and what he brings are accusations. What he brings is pride that leads to death. But when Jesus answers him with his life and a tomb and a cross, he tells us, I have come to give you life. It's that thing that we're searching for all the time. We're searching for freedom. We're searching for life. Personally, and I know some of you will disagree with some of my hobbies, or not disagree, but you won't enjoy some of my hobbies, and I get that. Especially if you've lived in southern Indiana your whole life, you haven't had an experience, or possibly haven't had the experience to go hike some mountains. But I love to hike mountains. I love to get to the top of a mountain. I'm not a big fan of hiking the mountain that you get to the top and you're still surrounded by trees. I want to hike the mountain that when you get to the top, you just see everything around you. When you get to the top of a mountain like that, if you have a personality like mine, and I understand not all of you do, but if you have a personality like mine, you get to a view like that, and you see for miles and miles, and it is life-giving. It is full of joy. It is one of the most peaceful places that I can imagine on planet Earth. But to get to that spot, I've got to hike up it. I don't do the whole cheating thing at Pikes Peak where you get to drive up to the top of Pikes Peak. I want to hike to the top of the mountain. But to get there, there are laws that I have to follow. Some of those are the laws of nature. I can't just fly to the top. I can't just jump. I'm going to get tired on my way up. There are laws of nature. There are spots on that mountain that I just cannot pass by foot. And then there are the laws of the National Forest Service, depending on which mountain it is that I'm climbing. But what I have found in my life of climbing mountains and in taking my family up mountains and getting lost on the way up mountains is that when you don't follow those laws, you don't reach the top. You don't get to enjoy the hike the way that it was meant to be enjoyed. You don't get to experience the life that there is to give on your way up and once you're up there looking out. See, the laws, they're not restrictive as I hike to the top of the mountain. They actually give me freedom. They give me freedom from the underbrush that would trip me up. They give me freedom from the poison ivy that might be hiding in the trees. They give me freedom from the snakes that would love to bite me. And they give me at least a modicum of freedom from the many, many insects that live off in the trees and the grass and the spiders that are out there. And they give me the freedom to see that view when I get to the top. What if there's an enemy who is just trying to convince us to ignore all of those? An enemy who wants us to get tripped up in the underbrush. An enemy who wants us to get bitten by the snakes. An enemy who doesn't care about the view at the top, but instead wants to imprison us on our way up there. And what if that's what Jesus came to free us from? There's a worship pastor down in Dallas that Doug Reynolds actually put me onto a book that he wrote. If you ever need a good recommendation for a book to read, go find Doug Reynolds. Some of you had him in fifth grade, and so you know, he knows how to teach and he knows how to lead. But this worship pastor by the name of Zach Neese wrote this, and I love how he said this about obedience. Obedience born of love is not religion. It's not restrictive. It is not works. It is not talking about doing things to earn salvation. But instead, it is talking about demonstrating affection for God from an authentically loving heart. Salvation, which was found on a cross and in an empty grave, demonstrates God's love for us, and worship, that part where we do follow the path that he leads for us, worship demonstrates our love for him. Will your life be different if you choose to follow him? Will there be some things that will change? Absolutely. There's no way around that. There are things inside our heart and there are things inside our mind that an enemy is attacking us with and trying to plant there that we will follow if we choose not to follow Jesus. But just because your life changes and just because it becomes different does not mean that it becomes restrictive. But rather, it becomes full of freedom. And it becomes full of life. Now, there is one option out there that says all of that is fake. That says it's all made up. I imagine that there are some of you in here this morning who doubt all of this stuff that we talk about on a weekly basis, on a daily basis. I imagine that there are some of you in here this morning who you have heard something said in a spot like this and it just didn't land. It didn't seem to come to fruition. And so it leaves you in a spot where you're ready to give up on all of it. Or at the very least, you are doubting everything. We are in a world that is searching for truth and coming up empty everywhere it looks. If you are one this morning who is, even those of you who come here every Sunday morning, I understand you may be sitting there coming here every Sunday morning and doubting all of it. That you haven't thrown yourself into this because you're not sure that any of it's true. And you are looking elsewhere to find the answers for life and the answer for truth. If you haven't found them anywhere else, what if that's because the answer is only found in Jesus? And if that is indeed the answer, if that is indeed the truth that you're searching for, would you not want to at least hear him out? Would you not want to at least see the life that he has for you? Because Jesus came and through a cross died, and through a tomb defeated that death. And his purpose for all of that was to give you life. Was to give each and every individual in this room and churches around the world and those who aren't going anywhere this morning to give life. The offer is out there, but he will not force you to take him up on his offer. The choice is yours. It always has been. It always will be. The choice is yours whether to accept the offer that he's giving you. So I ask you this morning, is it worth at least hearing him out? And if you're sitting here and you're going, I'm not sure that I buy it, but I at least want to hear about it. And I want to hear about this life that is offered there. I would love to meet you right here this morning. And it doesn't have to be me. There are people all over this sanctuary that would love to meet you this morning and to just begin introducing you to this man named Jesus. Not this man who was named Jesus, but this man who is named Jesus. He's waiting to meet you. And if you're someone who's here every Sunday, or you're someone who has said that you've decided to follow him, and you're sitting there and you're going, but I'm not sure I really know him. He's waiting to meet you too. You don't have to put on a fake show. You can be honest. And he's ready with open arms to meet you too. This morning, will you meet him? Will you come to him? And will you hear him out?